Good evening and welcome to Barrington's White House. I'm Roland Potter. Thank you so much for joining us as we come to the end of our Spring 21 season. Very different time for sure, and we appreciate your support and your attendance over this spring season. So as always, we want you to acknowledge our donors, sponsors, sustainers, individuals who have helped us through this season. And we're also encouraging you, of course, to look at our website for what's coming up in the summer. Sweet sounds of summers. We have some really interesting things in July. Start off with some bluegrass, barbershop quartets, some jazz, and a very important classical concert. So please join us in the summer. And tonight we have Diane Hines, a beautiful portrait artist, a beautiful still life artist. You're going to think that you're in some of the world's finest museums and galleries when you see her works. They're just wonderfully beautiful. And she's going to talk a little bit about her process, how she learned to do what she does so well. And I think you're really going to enjoy this evening with her. Enjoy, please.
Hi. Welcome to my home. Hi, I'm Diane Hines, and this is my home gallery. And we're going to show you some of my paintings and stuff. Tell you a little bit of story about some of them also. Maybe we could start with my very first oil painting I did when I was 11 years old. My father had had a serious heart attack, and way back when men had heart attacks, they had to stay home from work for a year, and a friend of his gave him an oil painting set. So he started oil painting. I used to watch him. And he said to me one day, why don't you do a painting? So I took a little canvas and I did the little floral painting and stuff. And as soon as I did that, I knew in my heart, this is what I want to do for the rest of my life. And that's what I've been doing. When I was in high school, I had really good art teachers. I went to Arlington High School. And I had Fritz Michaelis and James Pink, and they were fantastic art teachers, and they had a great art department. And so I always loved painting people. I loved doing portraits. Even then, when I was a young child, I would sketch my friends, and you know, the teacher, you know, walk through the classroom and she'd take it and then she'd hang it on the wall, you know, because it looked just like the person. I have a real knack for capturing a portrait. And I love doing still lifes because you can work from life. You know, still life isn't going to move. I like doing landscapes, but the lighting is constantly moving when you're out plein air painting and stuff. So a lot of times I'll start them out in the field and then I'll finish them in the studio. Same thing with my portraits. I always like to work from life as long as I can, but then I like to photograph my own photographs. I like to work from my own photographs. And when I'm working on a portrait, like this is my granddaughter, and she was only about 5 years old when she modeled for me for that. You know, I'd sit her in a chair for about 10, 15 minutes she would last, and then she'd say, I'm itchy, Grammy. And which meant I want to get up, you know, I'm uncomfortable. So then she would get up, move around and stuff, come back a little later and sit, you know, another 10, 15 minutes. So I kind of did her piecemeal, you know, and then I ended up taking photographs and finishing with the photographs. But I like working from life. That's you get the dimension of the face, you get a feel for the person's personality. You get so much more than you get from a photograph. And
so when you're doing a portrait like that, or like any of your portraitures, are you starting with a pen and pencil?
No.
Are you starting right away with oils?
Yes. I have, usually I tone my canvas, which is like a wash of just like a light brownish with some medium. That way it seals the linen and it becomes non-porous, so that when you're laying the paint on the canvas or linen, whatever you're using, the paint is sitting on top of the canvas. Because some grounds, like gesso and stuff, are very absorbent. So if you start painting on raw gesso, you're kind of dragging. Your paint is getting sucked right in. So I like to tone my canvas with a medium and a light wash of color. I never sketch it out. I just start painting. And I basically start out, obviously, with an idea in my head where I want to take this painting, what I want it to look like when it's finished. You know, just like, you know, they say to have goals in life, or if you're going on a trip, you map it out and stuff. With a painting, you want to know what you want it to look like when you're done. So you know how to approach your painting and what direction to go. And so then I put down the approximate size and the placement of the painting, and I don't get real involved at the beginning, because if you start drawing the eyes and getting the nose and getting everything all, you know, in there, and you get halfway or a quarter of the way through your painting and you spend a lot of time working on it, and you look back at it and you go, I don't really have that place right, or it's too big, or it's too small, or whatever, you don't want to erase it. You know, there's this, and then worse than that is if you proceed with that painting and something's wrong with it, you proceed and you're not really working accurately. You got this hesitation, this pulling you back from going ahead and finishing your painting properly. So I start the painting out very simple, and I like to leave some space around, you know, like a lot of times photographers, they crop in on things, people fill in the canvases and stuff, because like we're standing in this room across from each other, there's space around when you're with somebody, when I'm looking at the model. So I don't want to just zoom in on the face. I want to have some space around there so I feel the atmosphere around the person or the still life. It's important to have proper lighting and light and shadow in your paintings. Like, you want the face and the features all lit up, and then the shadow. Shadow is extremely important. Nobody really looks at the shadow except artists, you know. But if you don't have that strong structure of a shadow in your painting, your painting's gonna look very flat. All right, I'm gonna show you one of my plein air oil paintings that I did out in St. Charles. My son's an artist also, and he told me, oh, Mom, you got to go out to this field. It's black-eyed Susans as far as you can see. So he had gone out there and painted, and then a week later, he and I went together. And he actually stood in the middle of the field and painted in the opposite direction, and I stood outside the black-eyed Susan field and painted, you know, this little painting and stuff. I didn't finish it out there. We were out there probably for 3 or 4 hours, maybe longer, I don't remember. And then I finished it in the studio. Like I said earlier, going out plein air painting, you start, you know, in the morning, and then the sun is changing noon, and, you know, it's kind of hard because everything's changing. So what I do is when I get out in the field, I think about how long I'm going to be out there, where the sun is going to end up going by the end of the day, and where I want the sun in my painting. So I keep that in mind, kind of like I was talking about earlier, about knowing where your painting's going to go before you begin it. And so it's a little bit tricky, but, you know, when you get to know about light and shadow and all that sort of thing, you can figure it out pretty easy, you know. But it was, I love that painting. It's just, you know, so colorful and happy, and it's actually real simple, you know, like the flowers, but you get the feel of it being black-eyed Susans out there. Here is one of my favorite still lifes I did. I love the moodiness and the colors in it. It's very simple, but I love the atmosphere. When I'm doing a still life, it's really important to spend time setting up your still life. I don't just haphazardly, you know, put objects on a table and paint them. You know, I want to lead the viewer through the painting. I decide, you know, how slow or fast I want to bring them into the painting. Like on this particular painting, it's very dark. And there's not a whole lot of excitement on the left side of the painting. But the grapes lead you into the dark vase in the background, and then the vines that are over the pot, and the little fig plants. You know, so you bring the viewer into the painting, and then you pick out the object that you want them to focus on, which obviously is the blue and white little vase in this painting. And I really enjoy doing still lifes. Well, here are a couple of my simple earlier still lifes here. I was just noticing that I don't have varnish on that upper still life. Varnish is what I put on all my paintings when I'm finished with them after they dry. They have to dry for, you know, 3, 4, 5, 6 months, dependent on the thickness of your painting. And it kind of depends on the weather and stuff like that. But you want to make sure when your painting is done and it's dry that you varnish your paintings, because the varnish seals and protects the oil paint from, you know, pollutants in the air. And also even from UV rays and things like that. And a varnish, like say a painting, you know, is 50 years old and, you know, it's dull and stuff, they can actually strip a varnish off a painting, you know, clean the oil painting and then re-varnish it and bring it back to, you know, like brand new. So the varnish is protection for your oil paintings for over the years. And varnish is designed to be stripped off. So it breaks down with like a turpentine. So it's specifically designed to protect your paintings. Plus, another major plus about varnish is when you paint a painting, especially with dark colors, they get kind of dry and pasty looking when they're dry. And when you put the varnish on, all your color comes back to life, like when it was wet. When you paint a painting, when you put the color on, it's full color, it's wet. And then when it dries, it gets dull and pasty looking and stuff. So then it's one of my most exciting things to do is to varnish a painting, because then the painting comes right back to life when you put the varnish on it. So I varnish all my paintings, except that one I forgot. So, and then here is another, a little bit more detailed still life. This is a box, a toolbox with some machine parts or something. I don't know, I got it from my dad's garage. I found it kind of interesting. And, you know, just another still life that I love doing. All right, this is one of my paintings I did in China. I went to China with my friend Zhui Tu, with a group of artists I can't remember how many years ago, 10 to 15 years ago, we spent 3 weeks in China going to some really beautiful, very remote mountain villages and stuff. It was kind of like being in National Geographic for 3 weeks. And this, I'm not actually sure if it's a man or a woman, but I think it's a woman. These are bamboo, you know, like really tall. It was a bundle of bamboo that she was carrying. And she set it down to rest, you know. And I snapped this picture of her. Obviously, I didn't work from life on this one. But I just love her face and the emotion that you can see in her face and stuff. And what was interesting, when I was working on the painting, the bamboo, I wanted to put in very, you know, like loose and impressionistic and stuff like that. And I just banged that bamboo in like 15 minutes, just and I left it. And then either later that day or the next day, I looked at the painting. It was like, holy smokes, that bamboo is like jumping out at me. It's like one of the most realistic looking things in the painting. So, you know, it's just funny how sometimes things just appear in a painting. And the lighting, I loved the lighting that was on her. And it's just such a wonderful memory of my trip. And then I have this other guy who was playing a horn for us. There was a group of us artists. We had hired a guy to model for us. And then this next painting, he was standing in the background playing. You give him cigarettes and you know, they don't, you know, he's just so happy and stuff. Us artists were sitting. We had some guy we paid to sit and model for us. So he was sitting and we were all painting him and stuff. And then this guy was standing behind the group and he was playing his little trumpet or, you know, whatever that horn is. I'm not quite sure. And I took some pictures of him, and I love this painting. I love doing people and stuff, but the inside of that horn is like so real looking. When I look at that, you know, it just I find it very interesting. You know, and they have their little rags on their head and the little emblems on their shirts. And it's kind of interesting over there. A lot of the people, their clothes are all made out of the same fabric. It's like they get a couple bolts of fabric in the whole village. They all have the clothes that are made out of the same fabric. It's, you know, very interesting. But these are like I said, very remote mountain village people. Tourists, people can't go in and go to these villages that we went to, but my friend, he's friends with all the, you know, the government officials there and stuff, so we had carte blanche to, you know, go wherever we wanted. Okay, and then this is another one of my China paintings, you know, little woman sitting outside, you know, this is the door into her little house or living quarters, whatever you want to call it, and she was just so precious, you know. It was fun to go and meet these people and spend some time with them and stuff. They live a very hard life. They're very, very poor. Oh, one other thing, right there. That's a little fly on her on her sleeve. I debated putting it in there, and of course I did, so. Here are a couple of my animal paintings I've done. Kind of next to people, I love doing animals. I have a funny feeling it has to do with the eyes. You know, you got eyes, and there's something about eyes, like the soul of the painting. But this grizzly bear, a group of us artists went to Doug Seuss. He lives in Heber, Utah. He's an animal trainer for the movies and commercials and stuff like that. And he allowed us to come and take photographs of his grizzly bears and timber wolves and stuff. And he had his trainer there. I was actually really scared because I was, you know, like 10 feet away from grizzly bears that weren't behind a cage or anything like that. So, you know, there was maybe about five of us, and the trainer had like a bat in his pocket, but he would direct the bear to, you know, make some moves or do this and do that. It was really exciting, but it was really scary for me too. I'm kind of a chicken around animals. So, and this is a bighorn sheep. This is a friend of mine who's a really good wildlife photographer. And he had taken this picture of a bighorn sheep. That's where I got that subject matter for this guy. But I've done a lot of, you know, dog portraits, and I call them pawtraits. So I get a lot of commissions for, you know, mostly, you know, portrait commissions, but animal commissions too. And, you know, a variety of things. Here's another one of my granddaughters. This is my granddaughter, Maeve. She came and modeled for me, and one of my students painted her. And she's a very, very sweet girl. She looks like she's got a little bit of a puss on her face, but that's her personality. So, you know, I let it be like that, because somebody says, why don't you make her smile? I actually get that a lot about my portraits. Why don't you make them smile? And, you know, when somebody's sitting for hours, they're not going to sit there and hold a smile. So, and a painting is different than a photograph. So I have seven grandkids, and I haven't done them all yet, and some of them are complaining because I haven't gotten to them. So I'll have to get busy on that one.
Any tips or tricks for people getting started?
Back once again to, you know, visualizing your painting finished, how you want it to end up. And you get your size, your placement. I basically get the form in there. I start real simple, very simple, and work up to the detail. And then I get all my shadows in first, because like I said, the shadows are the structure of the painting. And then I work the light, and then finally the details. So yeah, there is a process of how I go through it. I don't like to, I actually used to years ago, I'd finish with the eye and then go on to the nose and stuff like that. And like I said earlier, you know, sometimes you get in trouble, then something's just not right in the painting, and you don't want to stop. You don't want to erase what you did, you know, because that eye is great. You know, it's perfect, but the painting's not right. So, you know, I like to start simple, big areas, and narrow it down as you go on and stuff. When I was 2 years old, my mother gave me a piece of paper and a crayon, and I was sitting on the floor, and I drew a person. And she saved the paper because I drew, you know, a head, eyes, nose, mouth, ears, a neck, shoulders. And not that it was a great drawing or anything, but she was like, you had every body part on that drawing at 2 years old. So
you were born to be an artist.
Yeah.
Destined. There was never any other option for you.
Right. So, you know, that's kind of a really special kind of memory for me, you know. And like my 11-year-old painting, when I actually did my first oil painting, that, you know, it just, I knew in my heart that this is what I wanted to do. So I'm, very grateful that I have the talent that God gave me and that I can do it, you know? I used to see this young man at church, and I just loved his profile. I loved his nose. And one day after church, I stopped him and I asked him, I told him, I'm an artist. I'd love to paint your portrait. And, you know, would you be interested in modeling for me? So he was, yeah, sure. So he came over, you know, and modeled for me. And he just had a white polo shirt on at the time. And then after he left, I grabbed a pillow, put it in the chair, you know, about where his shoulders were, wrapped this, you know, scarf around him and created, you know, the look of the painting. Because I think it's a little bit more dramatic having some of that fabric and stuff in there, you know. That's the problem with doing modern day portraits. You know, we look at the old world portraits and, you know, they're so exciting because the clothing and everything is so different and stuff. And that's kind of too, like when you go to China or, you know, Haiti or somewhere unusual and people dress different. Everything looks different. So it's interesting. But if you paint somebody who's, you know, like dressed like you and I and stuff, we look at it and they seem kind of boring. However, this is going to be the history of, you know, 100 years, 200 years from now, if your paintings survive, if they're, you know, produced properly and stuff, somebody's going to look at them. They're going to find them interesting. So I don't always like to change my paintings to look like they're from a different time or something like that. Because I liked, you know, artists are historians. We document history before cameras and stuff like that. That's how we have pictures, is from the artists of the times and stuff. So it's kind of interesting when you think about that. And also the paintings, I mean, they're 500 years old, 600 years old, 700,000. Photographs don't last that long. They're on paper. This is actually one of my students, William. And one day after class, I asked him if he would model for me, and he said yes. So he's actually a very good artist, too.
Do you have like that black background, or is that just kind of you toning out the whatever is in the background of your work?
No, when I set someone up, I will hang a fabric on the wall behind them, you know, black or green or whatever, you know, whatever color and stuff. Yeah, because you need to relate your color and your value relationships to what you're painting and stuff. So like if he was sitting in an all-white room and I'm deciding to paint him black, you're getting the reflective light on him and stuff. So you really have to control the whole environment when you're painting it. And then this is my grandson over here. He's standing in some tall grasses and stuff. This is a little bit different painting. I don't usually paint with the light in the back, but it was such a cute shot, I couldn't resist. So it becomes, you know, kind of tough because he's like haloed and outlined with the light behind him. So then you have to kind of make the dimension in the face to make it turn and stuff without having, you know, the strong light and shadows on the structure of the face.
So I see you have a 5-foot frame in the other room there. You have a painting planned or in the works for that?
Not for that particular frame right now, but I do a lot of very large oversized paintings. I used to do a lot of murals, like 20, 30, 40 foot long murals or entire rooms and stuff like that. So I'm not intimidated by the size of a painting, but I had done two young boys, two brothers, in a frame that's like about 5 foot tall. I think that one's about 5 feet tall. And the figures are almost life size. And It's kind of interesting, you know, like the one little brother is kind of standing behind the big brother peeking around and stuff. It reminds me of some of the old world type of paintings, like the Sargents and stuff like that. And, you know, that's one nice thing about doing a big painting. You got so much freedom in the area to, you know, put stuff. You get the real feeling of being in person with your subject and stuff.
So I guess, is it more fun? You said you're not intimidated, so I won't ask you if it's more difficult, but is it more fun to work on kind of a life-size piece than it is to...
Yeah, it's just different, you know. I mean, I actually like doing bigger paintings than small paintings. You know, a lot of times people say, oh, can you just do a small painting for me? And it's like, you know, those small paintings are really hard because, you know, the detail is so tiny and everything. And if you get anything off, it really shows and stuff. So I would rather do closer to life size. You know, maybe it's just, you know, a port. Well, that's smaller than life size. But I prefer doing closer to life size when I'm working on a portrait and stuff. I do a lot of portrait commissions. Most of my work is commission work. I like doing commission work. A lot of artists don't like it. They don't like people telling them what they want or how they want it done or whatever. But it doesn't bother me in the least. Right now, I'm actually doing a still life, and it's five generations of things in the still life. It is a little wooden matchbox that this man's grandfather had carved out and put it together. So that's hanging on the wall. And then his father was a farmer, and there's a bag of seeds for the seeds and some of his tools and a tomato. And then there's a young boy's baseball cap that was designed by the father. And then there's some of the son's objects and the grandson's objects in the still life. So it's like five generations of, you know, the men in the family, their objects. And, you know, that's really kind of special to create something like that.